Speaking of awkward situations, Julius Randle has now put himself in a catch-22 by upfront confronting the small portion of the Knicks fan base that trolls. They are by far the loudest, but him just acknowledging them upfront in the media, he's kind of put himself in a catch-22 because this very small portion of the Knicks fan base really gets off when they get a response. It's almost like adding fuel to the fire. And y'all know which portion of the fan base I'm referring to. The ones that will go to the Garden and wear paper bags over their heads. The ones that'll be cheering for Frank Ntilikina for MVP. Yo, they love Frank, man. I don't know what it is, man. I don't know what it is. But yeah, when you hear shit like that, you already know it's all for reaction. And they get off on that, but they are very loud. In fact, they are so loud that one time even James Dolan had to give a response. There was a person by the name of Evan Perlmuller who sold his fandom on eBay for $3,000 because he was upset of how the Knicks were performing that season. Of course, he was clout chasing because he quickly did an interview with a Lakers jersey on talking about why he sold his fandom, but he ended up selling it on eBay to a guy that was just trying to get clout for his YouTube channel. That's what I mean by a lot of these guys, man. They're just looking to be seen. That's pretty much it, but we gotta sort of destroy these paper bag Knicks fans that come to the Garden looking all stupid, trying to boo players. This little trolling shit, it's only a small percentage of the fan base, but we gotta kick that shit out because these type of Stephen A. Smith panicking Knicks fans, we don't need them in the fan base. They're straight up disgusting.
And I'm just seeing you already. I'm disgusted with you.
But I gotta ask myself, why did Julius Randle have to respond with the whole thumbs down thing? Because before, a few weeks earlier, he said that he didn't really care about what people had to say. But then all of a sudden, he had to have a reaction. And it's just like, damn, man, why? But then again, I gotta take a step back and look at last year's playoff series against the Hawks. I mean, in Julius Randle's eyes, he's gotta be looking at it like, damn, I put in work for over 70 plus games, playing great against good teams, bad teams, had an excellent season. But then we got to the playoffs and we had injuries at center. Nerlens Noel had issues. Mitchell Robinson didn't play in that series. And then we were so strapped at point guard that we had Derrick Rose looking gassed in the middle of the series. And that kind of led Julius Randle kind of being stuck. He easily got double teamed and the Hawks started crowding up the paint because there was no real threat down low, especially with Taj Gibson having to play at center. So the Knicks as a whole squad, it was limited. And he had that one bad series because of it, and the whole fan base just turned on him like that. He's got to be feeling the type of way about that. It's almost like, you mean to tell me you could be perfect for almost a whole season and have a bad series? Even with RJ disappearing, they didn't say nothing about that. They just picked on me? Like, damn. I'm telling you, Julius is feeling the type of way because of that series. He's like, this fan base is willing to throw me under the bus over a bad series where we just had limited options on our roster. I don't know, I feel like that left a sour taste in his mouth. And best believe, all these players, they have egos, man. And I know he's looking at RJ like, damn, this dude disappeared in this series, but just because he's homegrown talent, they're not gonna say nothing. And now RJ is in the middle of a contract year, and even though he had a bad month in November, nobody really said anything, but as soon as Julius Randle has a bad game, everyone notices. So he understands the fans are picking sides. And RJ Barrett slowly is kind of positioning himself as the alpha leader of this team, especially on the offensive end. And once again, like I said, all these guys have egos. And in a social media era where criticism follows you everywhere, I'm wondering if it's starting to get to Julius. But once again, the toxic portion of the Knicks fan base, which is a very small percentage, but it's the loudest. We got to get off that whole pinning RJ against Randle shit. Because you can sense it at the Garden, just the way they cheer for RJ versus Randle. It's a bit off and it's mad divisive, and we got to get rid of that shit. And that same trolley part of the Knicks fan base is doing the same thing with Obi. They're trying to cheer for Obi 10 times harder than Randle, and they're trying to pin them against each other. It's weird. It's a weird energy. That shit is off. We got to get rid of that. Because once again, no player is larger than the logo. It's about the squad. And once again, all these guys have ego. Every single one of them. You can't get to that level of being in the league without it. But I'm just wondering, with the combination of all the criticism Randle is getting and some of the trolling from the fan base, with the combination of RJ this season establishing himself as the 1A apex predator of this team, is causing Julius Randle to be off balance because the homegrown talent is starting to establish himself. It happens. Just because you're the highest paid guy doesn't mean you're the 1A. Remember, in the NBA now, The contracts go according to how long you've been in the league. So Randle, I believe being an 8-year veteran, of course he's going to make more money than RJ. But at the same time, that doesn't change the perception of that contract. Because the perception is by most of the fan base and media members is that Randle's getting paid the most, so he should be the 1A. So you see right there, there's the dilemma. Randle has 1A pressure, but he does not have 1A perception. Nobody perceives him as being the 1A of this squad, especially with RJ's play post-Christmas. Yeah, it's a lot to take in, man, and it's a weird dynamic right now because the team still hasn't addressed the point guard issue and the issue at center. Mitchell Robinson, Nerlens Noel, these guys are always in and out the lineups. You know, back-to-backs are kind of iffy. And offensively, these guys are still a bit shaky. So a lot of issues that we had last year in that series against the Hawks, they still have not yet been addressed correctly. They have been addressed, but they haven't been addressed correctly. So the answer was to get Kemba Walker and Evan Fournier. And then the Mitchell Robinson, Nerlens Noel issue is still kind of lingering on this season because it's not like it's really vastly improved from last year. So it's always important to take a step back and look at it from the player's perspective, because at some point, Randle has got to be thinking, when is the Knicks front office going to address some of these issues? Because it's clearly affecting his game. So James Dolan got to take some of that Illuminati protection off of Leon Rose and the media and have Rose speak up, man, and address some of these issues and some of the misses that happened this past offseason, especially with that Kemba Walker gamble. As we're seeing right now, it's looking like it's not going to work out.